I'll give an introduction. So, and we're projecting the slides. So that's great. Okay. Yeah, sure. So, why don't we get started? So, we are very happy today to have Anna Maria, sorry, Anna Fabiola Marino here in a European time zone. So, it's late in the evening for her. So, we're grateful she's able to join us and share her work with us. Her research is on globular clusters and specifically issues around multiple stellar populations as assessed from color magnitude diagrams and spectroscopic abundances. And a main aim of the work is to try to tie that into issues of reionization history and assembly of galactic halos. So that's a summary, I think, or an intro of what we're going to hear about today. In terms of her history, she received a PhD in 2010 from the University of Padova and was there in a joint program with the Universidad Católica de Chile. And after her PhD, she has conducted research at Max Planck in Garching and also then the Research School for Astronomy and Astrophysics at ANU. In 2015, she was awarded a Discovery Early Career Researcher Award, and that's an Australian Research Council prize. And in 2018, she was awarded a Marie Curie Fellowship. And recently, in the fall, November of 2020, she is now a staff member at INAF, the Italian National Institute for Astrophysics, at Arcetri in Florence. And so we're happy to have her here today. I'll say there are two early morning slots available at 8 a.m. and 8:30 a.m. tomorrow morning. If you'd like to sign up with a speaker, just send me an email and I can schedule that for you. So, okay, thank you. Please take it away.
Thank you for this introduction and thank you for the invitation to give this talk at your university. It's a pleasure to speak to this audience and talk about my work on multiple stellar populations in star clusters. First of all, yes, already Lynn has presented a bit of my history, my background. Yes, I show you some pictures of the places where I worked. I got my PhD at the University of Padova. This is the beautiful medieval tower with the old observatory. I spent some time in Garching at the Max Planck Institute. This is Mount Stromlo in Australia. And now I work in this very beautiful hill close to Florence, which is the Observatory of Arcetri, which is part of the National Institute for Astronomy in Italy. Okay, let me start with this globular cluster-centric history of the universe. Well, this is just to tell you that star clusters form along the whole timeline of the universe, starting very early, so a few hundred mega years after the Big Bang. Then we have some intermediate age clusters that formed when the solar system formed. And we have young clusters, some of them formed when dinosaurs appeared on the Earth. Well, most of my presentation will be about all the globular clusters in the Milky Way, which formed very early. So at the beginning of the epoch of star formation in the universe. And in particular, I'm focusing on the multiple stellar population phenomenon. We now know that this phenomenon is ubiquitous in Milky Way globular clusters. Its main feature is maybe the presence of light elements variation, so the elements that are involved in the hot hydrogen burning. We have helium, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, sodium, aluminium, and all of these elements are organized in well-known patterns, such as the carbon, nitrogen, the oxygen, sodium, the magnesium, aluminium anticorrelation. I will talk you more in details about the main properties of this phenomenon, but now I would like to tell you that it's a surprising variegate phenomenon. And I will try to envisage in this high variety some of the global properties of this phenomenon in the next slides. I think that you should keep in mind from now is that I will show you some observations, the observational results, basically. But at the moment, this phenomenon remains an enigma. So we have not understood the formation of multiple stellar populations in star clusters yet. This is the outline of my talk. I will start with a brief historical background of what we know about the multiple stellar populations. Well, going back in the time, I would go back to the 70s when we started to collect the first evidence of light elements variations in globular clusters. And this is a very important review, the first on this topic, which was done by Robert Kraft in 1994. He collected the abundances of all the clusters known at that time, sodium and oxygen, and you see here how sodium and oxygen are anticorrelated each other. He also collected the data for the S index, which is very sensitive to nitrogen abundances here. And you see that the distribution on this index is multimodal, indicating in each cluster, indicating the presence of stars with a different chemical composition. So at that time, we were aware of light elements variations, but these light element variations were observed in giants. At that time. So there was a lot of debate about the origin of this phenomenon, if it was due to some evolutionary effect of the star, and so maybe because of some effect of evolution in the atmosphere of the giants, you could see the variations of the observed variations. But there was also the proposal that these variations were primordial, so were imprinted in the stars when they were born. At that time, we did not have evidence of multiple populations along the color magnitude diagram. This in the 90s and later, we started to have very high precise data from the Hubble Space Telescope. And so we were able to construct very beautiful, I would say, color magnitude diagrams of globular clusters. This is NGC 2808, but look at this other one, which is from Richard et al. 2006. This is 97. And you see that this color magnitude diagram goes very faint in magnitude, but and it is consistent with a single isochron. So no evidence of multiple stellar populations from these precise HST CMDs. So precise CMDs from HST did not reveal multiple populations. Of course, here Omega Centauri was considered an exception. At the beginning of the 2000s, people started to analyze spectroscopically the stars that were distributed on the main sequence, on the Tarnoff, and on the subgiant branch. So basically, discussed the evolved stars. The first evidence that these stars have variations in light elements come from Cannon et al. 1999. This is 47 TAC, and he studied the CH and CN bands, finding the presence of CN strong and CN poor stars along the Tarnoff, the subgiants of these stars. Later, Gratton et al. Found sodium-oxygen anticorrelation among Tarnoff stars in NGC 6752. So these were the first evidence that the light element variations were present in scarcely evolved stars. And so this was a strong indication of the fact that these variations could be primordial and not due to evolutionary effects. But now we had a problem. How these light elements variations translate into a color magnitude diagram why at that moment we didn't see any evidence for these populations with the different chemistry on the color magnitude diagram. Well, the first connection between the light elements variations and the distribution of stars along a color magnitude diagram was done in this paper, our paper of 2008, and it was done on the globular cluster M4. Here you see, well, these are very, very good spectra, high resolution UV spectra for a large sample of stars. So it was a quite exceptional data set. And you see that we have a sodium oxygen anticorrelation, and we separated the stars into two groups. The first generation or first population, whatever you want, and the second generation or second population. And looking at the position on the color magnitude diagram with four stars with the different sodium, clearly they distribute on different sequences. But this is true if we use the ultraviolet to construct the color magnitude diagram. So for the first time, we were able to make a connection between the two techniques, I would say. And this was very important because realizing the important role of the ultraviolet, it was possible for us to construct, to design massive observational campaigns that were based on the ultraviolet. And actually, these observations, these recent observations, constituted the basis of our knowledge, today knowledge, on the multiple stellar populations in globular clusters. So now let's go to the latest results. This is the modern picture of a color magnitude diagram of a globular cluster. Again, this is from HST filter. And here we have the ultraviolet. This is again NGC 2808, but here you see how we don't see single sequences in any of the observed evolutionary stages. We see multiple sequences along the main sequence. We have multiple populations along the subgiant branch region, along the red giant branch. We have a multimodal elongated horizontal branch. So this is the model CMD of a globular cluster. And clearly it shows evidence of multiple populations. But I have to say that now the most powerful tool that we have to study this phenomenon is not the color magnitude diagram, but it is the chromosome map. This is a photometric diagram that we have introduced a few years ago. And this is an example for NGC 2808. It's constructed by combining different HST filters involving also the ultraviolet regions. And it is very powerful because it allows us to separate stars with even slightly different chemical abundances. So here you see that it's clear that we have five different populations that we simply named A, B, C, D, and E. And note that this is our photometric error. So this is a clear indication of the fact that we have at least five different populations on this diagram. What we did later was to introduce a chemical key to read these chromosome maps. To do this, we have investigated the chromosome maps of several globular clusters that are shown in this slide. And we have inspected the chemical abundances, in particular here, first population and second population stars on the chromosome map are separated by this dashed line. So in the green, there are the stars with available spectroscopical abundances on the first population, and in magenta, those in the second population. What was clear is that by looking at the chromosome map, stars in green, so first population stars located in the lower part of the chromosome map, are consistent with the chemistry, which is similar to the chemistry found in the halo. So in the field halo stars, so enhancement in alpha elements such as the oxygen abundance are enhanced, and then we do not have enrichment in sodium. While going to these other stars, so to the second population stars, we start enriching in sodium and depleting a bit in oxygen. From this slide, I would like you to remember that the multiple populations phenomenon is a variegated, as you can see in this slide. Indeed, we have many morphologies, and not two clusters are exactly the same. For example, we have chromosome maps that are very well elongated, like this one, and show the presence of many populations. Chromosome maps that are simpler, we have a less number of populations and they are not so extended. So this is a very variegated phenomenon. It looks like each cluster has developed its own multiple stellar population phenomenon in a different manner from other clusters. However, in this variegated zoo, which I tried to understand if the phenomenon has some global properties. To do that, we introduced the universal chromosome map, which is shown in this slide. This is basically a chromosome map that is constructed from the combination of the individual chromosome maps of different clusters. And it is plotted as a density plot, so you can see that we have two high over densities corresponding to the first population and the second population. So even if the second population is very extended, we have an high over density here, which means that even if the phenomenon is variegated, all the star clusters have developed the second populations, which is located here, and which corresponds to a given chemical pattern. This is the chemical abundance pattern for the universal chromosome map. So I have plotted the light elements as a function of the x-axis on the chromosome map. Again, in green and magenta, I have plotted the first population, so stars here, and the second population in magenta, the stars located here. It's clear that the light elements on the first population are homogeneous, despite the quite large spread that we see along the x-axis. On the other hand, we have large spreads in the second population stars, and when we get low values on the x-axis, we started to have larger variations, so for example, larger depletion in oxygen or larger enhancement in aluminium and depletion in magnesium. But maybe the y-axis is the one that tells us more about the chemical composition of the stars, because you see that we have a quite tight correlation between the y-axis and the sodium abundances. We have a beautiful anticorrelation with oxygen. And again, going up, so going to high values here, we start to see depletion in magnesium and higher enhancement in aluminum. To summarize, sensitivity of the chromosome map to the chemical abundances in this plot, I have shown you how the location on the chromosome map of each star changes by changing individual chemical abundances. So, for example, nitrogen, which is the most important element to shift the stars up, has been changed by 1.2 dex, which is more or less what we observe in globular clusters. Then we have helium, which increases in this direction, and the metallicity in this other direction. Anyway, what is important is that all this pattern is due, of course, to the combination of filters that we use, that in some cases are dominated, for example, by the OH, so the molecular bands that involve the light elements. Talking about the global properties of this phenomenon, we have also found that there is a quite a good relation between the fraction of the first population stars and the mass of the cluster. So less massive is the cluster, and higher is its fraction of first population stars, while Omega Centauri, which is the most massive cluster in our galaxy, has the lowest fraction of first population stars. Another good correlation is with the maximum variation in helium that is observed in globular clusters, which correlate with mass. Here I have plotted as a proxy of mass the absolute magnitude. Well, you see that here the most massive clusters have the higher internal variations in helium. On the other hand, the smaller variation are for the less massive clusters. So these are the global properties of multiple stellar populations. Basically, the mass of the cluster seems to be an important player in developing the shape, I would say, of the multiple stellar populations. Okay, now let's go to another topic, which is, in my opinion, is one of the most intriguing ones in the field of multiple stellar populations, which is the presence of a new class of clusters that we call anomalous or type 2 globular clusters. Well, why I define these objects as a new class of objects, of globular clusters at least? Well, first of all, looking at the chromosome maps, you see that the type 1 map that I have shown you before, it's consistent with several populations, but anyway, we have a main sequence along this photometric diagram. And these are the majority of globular clusters in the Milky Way. While the type 2 globular clusters have the main sequence here on the photometric plane, which is indicated in gray colors with the first and the second population stars. But then we have additional sequences along the red side that are not seen commonly in globular clusters. And Omega Centauri, which is represented here, it's clearly part of this type 2 class. But here you see that the situation is even more complex. We have very extended sequences on the red side. What's happening here? Well, I have to say that before the introduction of the chromosome maps, we were aware of some clusters showing some anomalies in the chemical abundances. Anomalies in the sense that, as I said you at the beginning, globular clusters were known since a long time to host variations in light elements, but not in the heavy elements. But in 2009, we have found that a globular cluster, M22, has a quite clear bimodality in the S process elements, for example, yttrium, zirconium, neodymium, lanthanum, and barium. So we have an S-rich group of stars and an S-poor or S-normal group in blue. Very interestingly, by looking at the S process element abundances as a function of the iron, we see that the S-rich stars are also enriched in iron, which is a quite important property because it indicates that this cluster has hosted supernovae to enrichment, so populations that have been enriched by the material released by supernovae type 2. It was very easy when we introduced the chromosome maps to associate these stars, so the S-rich and iron-rich stars, to the red sequences appearing on the chromosome maps. Indeed, we have iron that shifts the stars in this direction. Omega Centauri is, in the context of globular clusters, was always considered as an exceptional object. because of the large variations in metallicity, and it was associated to a different origin. So it was associated to the nuclear remnant of a dwarf galaxy, and this was also supported by the latest results from Gaia, for example. But here we have the chromosome map, and so we have another tool to investigate and further constrain its multiple populations. To investigate it, we have divided the chromosome map in three different streams: the lower, the mid, and the upper stream, and looked at the position along the sodium-oxygen plane of these stars. You see that we have that the lower stream stars are consistent with first population. Then we increase sodium, deplete oxygen, whatever is the x-axis value of the stars. And well, this is what we observe in all globular clusters: a sodium-oxygen anticorrelation and a change in sodium and oxygen going from the lower part to the upper part of the chromosome map. But what about iron? Iron is correlated with the x-axis of the chromosome map, as you can see here. So this finding, together with the finding on M22 other type 2 globular cluster, was used by us to observe clusters, type 2 clusters, and chemical tag their stellar populations on the red side. So basically, we could use photometry to select the candidate globular clusters to host variations in heavy elements, and we have observed them spectroscopically, and we confirmed for all of them basically that they have the same chemical pattern, so the variation in heavy elements. So what's the main property of these objects, type 2 clusters, besides of course the multiple chromosome map? If you look at this distribution of the absolute magnitude, the proxy of mass of globular clusters, you see that the type 2 globular clusters are the more massive ones. So they are the more massive. The spectroscopic studies were conducted on the most massive type 2 globular clusters. So basically with an absolute magnitude in V lower than -8, more or less. So now we have decided to study also the low mass tail of this distribution, and which includes two clusters, NGC 1261 and NGC 6934. This is the chromosome map of the clusters that we have analyzed, and the big colored points are the stars for which we took high resolution spectra. So we have high resolution spectra both on the normal sequence of the chromosome map and on the red one. And this is the distribution of our spectroscopic targets on a classical color magnitude diagram. This is a summary of the results. Well, in this part of the diagram, of the plot, nothing surprising because we have large variations both on the blue and on the red stars in the light elements like commonly seen in globular clusters. But what was surprising was this region of the plot in which there are the neutron capture elements that are homogeneous, so that there is no evidence for variations between the blue and the red stars. And this was surprising because all the other clusters, type 2 clusters, host variations in the S process elements. This is also seen in this plot where there is lanthanum, which is an S process element as a function of iron for NGC 6934. You see that again for iron, we see a variation. So the red stars are enriched in iron, but lanthanum is the same. For NGC 1261, was more difficult to make strong conclusions because here the difference is small, and also the sample size is very limited. We have just two stars on the red. So, but the indication is that we could have a small variation also in iron in the right direction. But what I want you to note here is that both clusters do not show evidence for enrichment in DS process elements. In this plot, I show you the fraction of the supernovae 2 material present in the red population stars. You see that in all clusters, in all type 2 globular clusters, this fraction is very small, relatively small, is smaller than the 2%. Only in the most massive ones, we have higher fractions. Here I show you the iron, the additional iron locked in the red population stars as a function of the present day mass. We found a correlation. And for these two clusters that are the less massive that we have analyzed, we don't have S process element enrichment. So from this new study, we have a new question. Is there any threshold in the globular cluster mass to support the enrichment in the S process elements? We have two clusters at the moment, and yes, both of them do not have variations in S elements. This is a list of the globular clusters for which we know heavy element or iron variations. It's not a complete list. We are updating it. But we can say that from the 60 clusters for which we have a chromosome map from Hubble Space Telescope data, the 18% of these clusters are type 2, which means that this phenomenon is not so rare in the Milky Way. So metallicity, heavy elements variations are present in the 18% of globular clusters in our galaxy. And this is an important phenomenon to be understood. Why? As I said, because the enrichment in iron is an indication of supernovae 2 based enrichment. Type 1 cluster have uniform iron and metallicity and in general heavy elements. We go to type 2 clusters like M22, we start to see some variations in iron, but also in the S process elements, as I told you. This is Omega Centauri, large variations, another type 2 cluster. And it looks like these type 2 globular clusters could be something in between type 1 normal globular clusters because they have the light element variations and the light element anticorrelations, and the more massive systems like dwarf galaxy that instead host variations in metallicity and in the heavy elements in general. So the intriguing questions here is, are we looking at dwarf galaxies remnant? So the type 2 clusters could be similar to Omega Centauri, for which it has been proposed since a long time that it is a remnant of a dwarf galaxy. This is a map of the Milky Way satellites. I have taken it from Helmut Jørgen at the Mont Stromlo website. What is interesting to me here is the Sagittarius dwarf galaxy, because it has a globular cluster in its center, which is actually one of the type 2 globular cluster. It's M54. And it has variations in the metallicity. So the question is if all these other clusters that we know to host variations in metallicity were at least similar to M54 in the past. So maybe now we observe the naked globular clusters and M54 will appear like a naked globular clusters in the future when all the Sagittarius surrounding the galaxy will be stripped off. So that's an idea. But with the new observations from the HST, We are also investigating another intriguing phenomenon, which is this one. So the elongation of the first population stars. As I said you, this diagram, the chromosome map, is sensitive to the chemical abundances, and surely these first population stars here are not chemically homogeneous. So what's happening here? A possibility is that we have metallicity variations that are a more widespread phenomenon, not confined to this type 2 clusters, but also present among normal type 1 clusters with elongated first populations. Well, to try to understand this phenomenon, we took some high resolution spectra again with the UVS spectrograph. And four stars distributed along this first population. And try to understand, first of all, if helium can produce this elongation. You see that here, increasing helium, we go in this direction. Of course, for giant, it's hard to measure helium. So what we could do is a measure of light elements like sodium, oxygen, magnesium, and aluminum. And the results of the stars are the dark green points here and here. So you see that we have a consistency with the light green points that are the first population stars. So no variations in any of these light elements. So it's very, very hard to believe that we have variations in helium, but not coupled with the variations in the other light elements. So another reason for this elongation could be the presence of binaries. Indeed, if we look at the simulations that we did, we have that binaries have the property to shift the star, binarity shifts the stars in this direction, to low direction of the chromosome maps. Well, this simulation is done by considering 100% of binaries both in the first and in the second population. The simulated points are the colored points in blue and red, while the observed points are the gray ones. You see that this is not a great overlap, so we tried with another simulation in which we simulated the 13% of binaries and belonging just to the first population. 13% is a constraint that is given by analysis of binaries along the main sequence. And here you see that we do not have many binaries here in the second population, but we can account for the chromosome map here only by taking the first population binaries. However, even in this case, even if the match is better, it looks like we have a lot of stars here in the elongated first population stars, and we do not have enough binaries to reproduce them. So binaries could have a role, but probably it's not the whole story. So what about metallicity? As you see, iron shifts star, increasing iron shifts stars on the red. So here we should have lower iron. In this plot, I show you lanthanum, which is an S-process element, as a function of the scatter in the radial velocity. The shaded area is the area of binary candidates because of the radial velocities or because they have high lanthanum abundances. Looking at the stars on the chromosome map, this is the x-axis of the chromosome map, you see that the three binary candidates have the lowest values of the chromosome map that we have observed. And so this means that indeed the binaries can have a role. But if you look at the other stars that are not binary candidates, we have here the iron color bar. You see that these stars at lower X have lower iron abundances. The variation is small, but possibly a combination of binarity and metallicity could be the responsible of the elongation of the first population stars. Of course, understanding this phenomenon is difficult. Well, we can have a self-enrichment among the first population, or we can explain it also by considering inhomogeneity in the original molecular cloud from which the protocluster formed. I would like to finish this discussion on multiple stellar populations by showing you just a few results on young clusters, so those that formed recently, both in the Magellanic Clouds and in the Milky Way. The first evidence of multiple stellar populations in Magellanic Cloud young clusters were done around 2007 and were basically consistent with the double main sequences and extended the main sequence turnoff. A possible explanation for this behavior was that the stars in these young objects, I'm talking about ages smaller than 500 mega years, have a different age, so a spread in age. If the explanation is a spread in age, well, it would be easy to associate these objects to the old globular clusters with the multiple stellar populations, because one of the most acknowledged scenario is that multiple populations in old clusters correspond to different bursts of star formation. This phenomenon was also observed more recently in the Milky Way open clusters at similar ages. Again, multiple sequences or spread sequences and extended main sequence turnoff. This was thanks to Gaia data. So this is a universal phenomenon. It's not proper of Magellanic Cloud clusters, but it's present also in our round Milky Way. However, another possibility to explain these observations is that it's due to stellar rotation, to different rotations of the stars. And we have provided the first direct evidence of this, so of the role of rotation, by studying NGC 1818, which is a young cluster in the Magellanic Cloud, a large Magellanic Cloud. You see that the spectra on the blue and the red sequence that we have analyzed are consistent with the different shape in the spectral lines that correspond to clear different rotation. Here is the projected rotational velocity as a function of the color. You see that we have a population of slow rotators on the blue side and a population of fast rotators. So maybe it would be possible to explain this phenomenon without invoking spread in age, but just considering rotation. Stellar rotation. And this was also found in the open clusters. These are some spectral features that we have analyzed in one open cluster on the blue side and on the red side of the main sequence. And these are the corresponding numbers. Again, the red stars have higher rotation with respect to the blue stars. Now, from these observations, it looks like age can be ruled out. And maybe these objects are not the counterparts of all the globular clusters that form the high redshift. However, this is still an ongoing problem because some studies find some features along the color of magnitude diagrams that are better reproduced, for example, with a small difference in age. So, yes, this is an ongoing issue. This is a summary of what we know today about the multiple stellar population. So we have chromosome maps that allowed us to understand a lot of properties about this phenomenon. We now know that there are several globular clusters that have heavy elements variations. We have discovered an inhomogeneity in the first population stars that could be due to small metallicity variations. We know more about multiple populations in young clusters that seems to be unrelated at the moment to the old globular clusters in the Milky Way. What are the future challenges and what are the observations that can help us to understand this enigma? Well, first of all, the James Webb Space Telescope will open the frontiers to the exploration in the infrared domain for the globular cluster multiple stellar populations. And in particular, it will allow us to study the multiple stellar populations in the M-dwarfs domain. Indeed, we have a James Webb Space Telescope approved proposal that is aimed to the understanding of the formation of this phenomenon by observing the M-dwarfs. These observations will tell us if the globular cluster hosted the multiple bursts of star formation, as some scenarios predict, or if the populations are coeval and they are the consequence of some accretion phenomena. And this will be done by investigating stars at different mass. This is just a summary of what we will do with the James Webb data. So we will get both spectra and photometric, this is from HSD, this is a simulated spectra. The spectra simulated have been done with a different oxygen. We will observe 47 TAC. And you see that the spectra will tell us about the oxygen abundances in these stars in the different populations and to be compared with the range that we observe in other evolutionary stages, so at a different mass domain. We will also use photometry in parallel observations and get photometry. In particular, we use these three filters that are the best ones that allow us the separation of different stellar populations with the different oxygen. In this way, we will be able to derive mass functions along the color magnitude diagram from the Lohmann sequence, from this faint part of the color magnitude diagram, so from the M-dwarfs to the upper main sequence and the red giant branch. Combined with the oxygen abundances, the mass functions will tell us if we have differences in the multiple stellar populations pattern between different masses. And this will tell us if we had accretion, a bonded bond-like accretion, so we have multiple generations of stars. Because in the second case, we expect to observe exactly the same pattern of multiple stellar populations among low mass stars and higher mass stars. Otherwise, the pattern would be different. I leave you with my conclusions. At the moment, we have an incoherent picture of how multiple populations formed in globular clusters. We know that the mass of the cluster, had an important role, both in type 1 globular clusters, because we have larger helium variations and also the fraction of the first population is different depending on the mass. But MAS is an important player also in anomalous type 2 globular clusters, because also in these objects we find a different chemical pattern which is somehow related to the mass of the globular cluster. We have found a new phenomenon, the heterogeneity of first population stars, that could be to metallicity and possibly to the inhomogeneity in the molecular cloud from which globular clusters form, the type redshift. Young clusters at the moment seems to be a different phenomenon. Of course, understanding this understanding all this phenomenon has many implications in several fields, from the galactic halo formations, the Milky Way satellites, the cosmic reionization, stellar evolution, and the nucleosynthesis models. And yes, I conclude with this slide, and thank you for the attention.
Thank you. That was me hitting the record button by mistake. I was getting ready to hit the unmute button. My apologies to everyone. So the presentation is open for questions. I'm looking at the chat, so people can type questions there or raise your hand in the participants tab. And I have a few questions, but I'll defer to others first. So Ilaria, you have your hand up, go ahead.
Hello. I have a question about the clusters in the LMC. Mm-hmm. So you thought that, you know, you mentioned as a possibility the fact that, you know, if we see difference in ages, those could be kind of precursor of these multiple populations. But what kind of difference in age do you expect to see to create those different populations? Because it might be just too small to detect just from the CMD, right?
Well, the range in ages that I would expect from in all the globular clusters strongly depend on the scenarios. Because depending on the nature of the polluter, of course, the evolutionary time is different, and so the age difference that I expect is different. For example, there are some scenarios for which the polluters were massive stars, so I expect very small differences in that case. Or AGB stars, in that case, I expect differences of a few hundred mega years. So also for all the globular clusters, it's difficult to tell what I expect, because it depends on the scenario. And of course, for an old population, unfeasible to find such variations in age based, for example, on the turnoff. For younger population, it's easier. I can detect variations in age, but the problem there is that, for example, by looking at the turnoff extension, here you have a degeneracy with the rotation, so you cannot distinguish between rotation and age. And this is why, yes, we took spectra and to constrain at least the rotation. And we found evidence of this bimodality in the stellar rotation that apparently can account for also for the spread in the main sequence turnoff. However, if you look at some color magnitude diagrams that I have not shown here, however, there are some studies that there are some features that are more difficult to explain with different rotation. I don't know if it's a problem of the models, the rotational models, or if something else is going on there, for example, the difference in age. So this is a completely open and interesting issue.
Thank you.
There are a number of questions about the chromosome map, so maybe you could backtrack in your slides to that early section of the talk. I had one here as well, but George Dragosky, you have your hand up, so I'll let you ask your question, and then Michael Kuhn, and then I'll jump in on this topic as well.
Well, thank you. First of all, really nice work and great data. So I have a question is, how are the populations defined in this feature space? For example, this one, clearly I can see that there are three clusters, but I'm puzzled why the bottom one is cut into A and B and the top one is cut into C, D and E. Use any objective clustering, unsupervised clustering algorithm and information criterion to decide on the number of populations?
We tried to use some clustering criteria. At in the end, I think that the best way to define the population was by high and by considering the photometric error here. So we tried some clustering, but in the end, we did not find the algorithm that could visually separate better the stellar population each other. Of course, here I say, okay, there are five populations, but if you look at the extension of the different populations and you look here at the photometric error, you see that each population might host internal heterogeneity. So it's very hard to separate, to cluster the stellar population in different definitive stellar populations here. It's something like that each population is more continuous, so has a more continuous chemical enrichment here. So yeah, this is simply here in the first population because we see an elongation. So we have divided it, which is not consistent with photometric error. We have divided it in two populations. And this is the phenomenon that we are trying to understand, which is the reason for this elongation. So the number of population is indicative.
Well, I'm sorry, but just chopping them arbitrarily like this is not really the best way to go about it. Clearly, there are trends there. There are correlations. I mean, these clusters are elongated, and that's because something's going on. That's the way their probability distribution is. I think there are many good algorithms that will give you clear and objective definitions. This is a blatantly obvious one, and you'll get three clusters.
Yeah, here it's quite clear, I think. The first population is,
right. I mean, I looked all of your other diagrams, and oftentimes, you know, mostly you see two and sometimes three, except for Omega Centauri, which is in a class by itself. But it seems to me that it would be good to do a really objective, well-defined analysis with information criteria that will clearly define how many distinct populations are. And then you can ask interesting questions. Why are correlations present and stuff like that?
I wanted to jump in here as well. Can you scroll back a little further? You had one of these in a Hess diagram format, a few down maybe. Yeah, this one. Is that data or is that a simulation of some sort?
Data.
Okay, and so in this, so, you know, kind of related maybe to the previous question, right? Here, there's clearly, you know, some kind of core halo, you know, elongation structure to this. Physically, that must mean something, I guess. Are there ideas about that as opposed to just, you know, different groups? It's more the entire distribution.
Well, yes, this is, these are data, and these are, this is constructed by, putting all the chromosome maps that we have observed for individual clusters to a metal-free plane to remove the metal dependence, because also the elongation of the chromosome maps in both directions depends on the metallicity. So we do a procedure to remove this dependency. And we got this chromosome map by combining all the maps each other. Yes, physically, what I would say here is that, the first population is quite well-defined, and then we have an elongation in the second population. But we have an overdensity, which is in this point here, which corresponds to a second population, which is present in all globular clusters. And this elongation, physically, is the presence of additional populations in some of the clusters, for example, NGC 2808, that besides this main second population that is present in all the globular clusters, we have other populations that have a more extreme composition in oxygen, in sodium. So yes, this is the physical reason. So the message to take from this is that the second population is common to all globular clusters, while there are some other populations that are present just in some of them.
And then, Michael, did you want to ask your question?
Yeah, so thanks for the nice talk. I was wondering, can chromosome maps be generated for field stars? And you might have partially answered this in your previous question, but in general, I'm wondering about differences in enrichment processes for globular clusters versus the field.
Well, it's for the field, these are relative. I explain you how we construct the chromosome maps. Well, we take two super photometric diagram, I would say. One highly sensitive to nitrogen by using this combination, and the other one with the large color baseline, so by using ultraviolet, infrared, and so making a diagram which is very sensitive, for example, to helium, to temperature. When we have these super photometric diagrams, we verticalize them. And so the position of each star along this verticalized diagram are the of the two diagrams are the Y and the X axis of the chromosome map. So for the field, yes, you cannot construct them. It would be interesting, but no, you can construct for globular clusters because it's a relative measurement.
Okay, thanks. And are these maps implying a difference in enrichment processes in globular clusters compared to what produces enrichment in field stars? Are these maps implying a different enrichment process affecting the chemical abundance in chemical abundances in globular clusters compared to what happens in galaxies for field stars?
Yeah, well, if you consider them the Milky Way in the field, in the old field stars, we don't see many stars that are here. At the moment, from spectroscopic surveys, they observed roughly the 2%, 4% stars with this composition, while most of the stars have a composition similar to the first population stars. And sodium oxygen anticorrelations, magnesium aluminum anticorrelations are seen only in globular clusters. So there is a chemical enrichment actually that has occurred only in these objects and not in the field. And also compared to the other galaxies, we do not find in the field such chemical abundances. So we have a chemical enrichment which has occurred in the environment of a globular cluster and not in the field. Indeed, one of the explanations for the few stars that we find in the field with this chemical composition is that they have been originated in a globular clusters and then they were lost in the field. But it's typical of globular clusters.
Thanks.
Okay, we've lost well more than half of our audience and it's past the top of the hour now. So if there are other questions, please feel free to raise your hand. Otherwise, maybe